Okay, everybody. How y'all doing? I'm Brian, and I'm not going to be actually talking a whole lot about Palm, but it's all related to Palm. I'm going to be talking to you guys today about PhoneGap, and more so about the mobile web. So my name is Brian. I work at Nitobi Software in Vancouver. I mostly hack around with JavaScript, although I do a lot of other things too. My girlfriend thinks I look like Fry, so that's my picture. No, my girlfriend does not. She does have one eyeball. She also has another one. So, so Nitobi Software is a really small software consultancy in Vancouver, Canada. We're all about the web. We're all about open source. And we make money doing consulting, support, and training. A lot of people ask us, like, "Yo, you're the PhoneGap guys. How do you make any money?" And like all things open source, we make money off the ecosystem of PhoneGap. So we write mobile applications. And so I wanted to thank Ben and Dion for having me down here and showing a funny picture of me. And I put a bounty on the internet for a funny picture of Ben and Dion. I didn't get two funny pictures, and so we'll just keep that. We'll keep that for a future presentation. All these slides will be available online. And thank you to Palm for having me. This is a really cool event, and I'm super excited about the webOS platform. Here's a quick link dump if you don't want to pay attention to me, and you are a fast typer. The last two have nothing to do with anything at all, but they're two fun side projects of mine. If you think JavaScript is a bit of a quirky language, you're right. And if you like Laffey and Douglas Crockford, the last one's hilarious. Douglas Crockford wrote JavaScript the Good Parts, which was mentioned in the last presentation. So in the mobile web, we've got three really big problems. We've got native app fragmentation, which Ben and Dion spoke to really well in the first session today. We have a whole bunch of DOM manipulation libraries that try and fix the cross-browser incompatibilities. And then we've got the question of offline storage. And so when you've got problems, sometimes when you solve them, you create value, and that's something that we've been working on at Nitobi. And we have three potential solutions for these problems that I'm going to talk about to you guys today. So PhoneGap has been getting a whole lot of attention in the past year and a bit since we released it. And I'm going to go through the project philosophy. It's really important to understanding what PhoneGap's all about, a little bit about the history, and where PhoneGap's going. Who here has heard of PhoneGap? Okay, that's cool. Like a year ago, everyone would be looking around. So now most people have heard of it, and we'll talk more to exactly what it is. Before we get too deep into PhoneGap itself, how many iPhone developers do we have? Don't be shy. All right, there's a few of you. Former iPhone developers, right? Apple's new 3.3.1 clause caused a big stir. It does not affect PhoneGap. We play within their sandbox of rules that arbitrarily changes at will. They're concerned that they wanted to make sure people were writing apps using only public SDK APIs. We do. We only write, PhoneGap is written with Objective-C and it executes JavaScript within WebKit. So just to clear that up, we're okay on 3.3.1. Yes.
But they said they're not going to support third-party platforms.
So PhoneGap isn't a third-party platform. PhoneGap is a starting point based on Apple's platform. Think of it that way. The question was, can you write iPhone apps with PhoneGap? And the answer is yes, it's true. And so here's the current native mobile ecosystem. Apple's iPhone OS, which also means that we can develop apps for iPod touches and iPads, is Objective-C, which is a kind of archaic, weird language. Google Android is actually a really beautiful platform, and it's written with its own sort of flavor of Java, these plain old Java objects executing in a VM called Dalvik. RIM has their own flavor of Java, which is horrible. It is. It's horrible. And then, well, yeah. Well, it's good because it's Java, but it only their SDK only works on Windows, so fail. Then you got Nokia. This isn't actually totally correct, because Nokia doesn't own Symbian. Symbian is its own foundation. Nokia also does a platform called MIMO, but they recently renamed it MIGO because they merged MIMO with another platform called Moblin from Intel. If you're confused yet, I imagine you are. I am too. The good story about Nokia is they kind of support everything, all types of development. You can do Python, you can do C++, you can do web technology with their WRT platform. But the problem with doing everything means that you don't do one thing really well. And so that's just an interesting thing to know about Nokia. Palm Web OS nails it. It's web technology, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. You guys all know that. And then there's the Windows Mobile and Windows 7 phone world, which is essentially .NET. So if you want to build an app and you want to get the widest possible reach, you only have to know 6 different target languages and platforms. No problem. Actually, that is a problem. And distribution is also a nightmare. And this isn't something that we're necessarily solving with PhoneGap, but it is a problem in general. How do you get your app on all these platforms? So turns out that there is a way to do this, and that's the mobile web. If you want to write once and get it everywhere, or like we like to say at Nitobi, write once and debug it everywhere, the web works, and it always has worked. And so this is a basic philosophical underpinning of what PhoneGap is about. PhoneGap is a progressive enhancement technique. We don't think you should be writing PhoneGap apps. We believe you should be writing web apps. And then you can use PhoneGap to package your application and deploy it to all these other app stores. And this is really similar to what Ben and Dion were saying. We believe in the web as a first-class platform. We think that the web should have access to device APIs. We think we should have access to device data. And at some point, we're hoping we're going to have good tooling for the web, which is something that we all have to work on. So PhoneGap, roughly a year ago, was only iPhone, Android, BlackBerry, and now today we support iPhone, Android, BlackBerry, webOS, Symbian, MIMO, MIGO, and Windows Mobile and Windows Phone. And if, can you guys read this URL down here fairly well? If you have a browser, pop that open. It's a shorter URL to a Google spreadsheet. It's lightly out of date, but it lists all the devices that PhoneGap currently supports, and it's a very large list. That list also actually shows screen dimensions and pixel densities, which is a real challenge when working with the mobile web, as there's all these different windows to the web.
How long does it take for you to support a device, say a new device comes out today from Motorola? How long will it take for you to be supporting that?
So the question is, how long does it take for us to support a new device? Well, it depends. A lot of new devices right now typically are running on one of the platforms that we've already listed, or at least one of these operating systems, and if it does, then it just works. When we come across a new operating system, then we have to evaluate it on a case-by-case basis. But there is actually one new one that we're paying attention to right now, and that's Samsung Bada. And because it's an open source project, I can safely say that it'll happen eventually. Yes. Actually, we do, yeah, so that's a good point. We do support desktop development with PhoneGap. You can develop for Mac and Windows currently. We haven't done anything with Linux because we haven't decided what we're going to do there. We're not super focused on the desktop, but we recently got commits back for doing desktop dev with PhoneGap, and so we're accepting them back into the repo. That's an interesting point. So PhoneGap abstracts the native browser, and then we augment it with JavaScript APIs for device sensors and device data. And when we first started with PhoneGap, it was about a year ago at iPhone Dev Camp, actually 2 years ago, August 2008, at iPhone Dev Camp, we knew we could instantiate a web view, Chromeless, from Objective-C. We knew we could inject JavaScript and evaluate it from Objective-C, but we didn't know if we could call out from that JavaScript back to the native code. And that was going to be the key to doing this. And we got down there and we talked to a bunch of people at Apple, and they're like, no, it's totally impossible. The only way that you can get out from Objective-C is through the URL of the browser. And then we're like, oh, sweet, okay, so we can get out. And so we create our own little custom protocol called gap:// and all calls go out through the URL. And this is actually how IADS works and other Apple kind of sanction techniques. And we just started adding APIs. And the very first API was really funny. It was just a div on the screen. And Rob and Brock came back to Nitobi, and they're like, check it out, dude. And they're like moving the iPhone around. And it captured the accelerometer data, and it moved this div around. And we're like, oh my god, this is amazing, which at that time it kind of was. So, you know, it was a native device API coming back to the browser instance, and that was cool. So accelerometer was first. We implemented geo before any browser, but that's not totally true because Google Gears did it before anybody else. So Google Gears kind of set the pace for that. We've implemented camera, so access to the camera and access to the photo, so access to the sensor and the data, they're discrete things. Vibration, contacts, support, SMS, telephony, also email, sound, video. Reachability is to know if you're online or offline. We used to just ping Google and get it, see if we got a 200 response, but we realized that wasn't a very professional way of doing it, and so we've now abstracted an actual network API. Magnometer is sounds like a superhero, it's actually just a compass. And we also get the benefit of being able to do anything the browser does, which is huge because most of these platforms support a variant of WebKit. A really big key to all this is PhoneGap is a starting point for your software development. It's not the end point. And so there's nothing in PhoneGap that prevents you from augmenting with native. PhoneGap allows you to start writing native and web code at the same time and mix and match. And so all the PhoneGap projects share the exact same structure. Somewhere within the target platform that you're developing for, there will be a www folder. In that, we require an index.html file that includes phonegap.js. That's it. That's all you need. And then you can drop this into any PhoneGap project for any specific platform, hit compile, you have a native app for that platform. I talked a little bit about this. And I just like that picture because it's funny. It has nothing to do with anything. The PhoneGap technique is we create a Chromeless browser instance in every case. We execute JavaScript from that native code. And then if we can, we call out from that native code back into, or call out from the JavaScript back into the native code. Every platform gives us different tools for doing this. Obviously with Palm Web OS, we're lucky because this is just the, how it works from the beginning. So PhoneGap for webOS is simply a JavaScript shim to match our APIs back to the Mojo APIs. In the case of the iPhone, we're instantiating the browser, we're executing JavaScript in it, and then we're calling out through the URL. In the case of Android, it's a beautiful architecture. We can bind Java objects right to the browser instance, and they become available as JavaScript objects, which is huge. This is really how it should be. In the case of BlackBerry, we gave up. We tried everything, we couldn't get it to work, and then one of our developers had been drinking too much coffee or beer, who knows which, and probably both, and he realized that there was a shared memory space between the browser and the native code. He could instantiate a Chromeless browser, and he found that cookies were being written to this one memory space. And so PhoneGap for BlackBerry, believe it or not, is constantly reading and writing cookies. Which is a hardcore, crazy hack, but it actually works. And it's fairly performant, so that's actually pretty cool. And all the other platforms are similar stories. A big question we always get is, how do you guys maintain compatibility across platforms? And we have another project called Mobile Spec. And we call it Mobile Spec, not PhoneGap Spec, because we're hoping that this could become some form of a standard for other implementers in the future. Mobile spec is written in QUnit, which we were startled to find runs in every mobile browser. So that's a good note. If you're doing mobile JavaScript development, we totally recommend QUnit. It's also asynchronous, which is nice. And we have failing specs. And this isn't a bad thing from a test-driven perspective. This is a good thing because this gives us indicators of health in the areas we need to work on. And so iPhone and iPhone, Android, and Palm are what we're calling our first-class browsers. They tend to be the best of the breed. Second class would be like Android 1.5, perhaps MIMO. And then third class, we get into the world of BlackBerry and Symbian, where we have a lot more red, and a lot less. Should be green, but it's blue. And so mobile spec is a good indicator of health. It also allows us to know when we truly are cross-platform. Our target abstraction with PhoneGap right now is JavaScript. And so our tests are in JavaScript. We started writing our tests in Objective-C and Java, and then we realized, we're like, well, what if the tests are out of sync, right? We might get green across the board, but we wouldn't know if our abstraction was true. And so this gave us a way to actually test what we were abstracting. PhoneGap is aiming to be a standards-based implementation. And we're favoring compliance over conformance. And this means that we recognize there are standards and we're trying to give a path forward with those standards, but not always are the standards rooted in the reality of the mobile world today. And so in some cases, the standards are being authored with an eye to the future, where the devices are a little more powerful than they are today, with more API support than they have today. And so we're watching these standards really closely. The first one's called the Device API Working Group. These guys are looking to bring these APIs to the device sensors and data back into the browser, which is fantastic. And PhoneGap apps will be compatible with Device API spec, which means that if you write to PhoneGap, you will be not only portable across all these platforms, but you'll be portable to the browsers of the future. We're keeping an eye on HTML5 because it's obviously really closely related to WebKit. And we think that the W3C widget spec is actually an interesting analog to how apps are written today, especially Mojo apps and WRT apps in the case of Symbian MIMO. PhoneGap is MIT licensed. Yes, a question.
I'm just wondering, maybe offline or later you can bring this point. There's a lot of debate between Flash 10.1 and HTML5.
So Flash 10.1 hasn't shipped yet. So as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't exist. A press release is not code I can write against. So
from Apple's perspective, you know, like Apple is not supporting Flash, Android is supporting Flash. So does your phone gap, bridges a gap between the two, or you, this is not that you as a company are concerned about?
Yeah, we're not interested in Flash.
And the reason is?
It hasn't shipped yet. If there's something I can write code against, I might be interested in as a target implementation technology, but until there's like code, not a blog post, I can't do anything with it, right? So MIT licensed. PhoneGap is free open source software. MIT license is the most liberal and compatible license in our belief. It's compatible with Apache and BSD variants. And so it's free for you to use, redistribute, modify, sell, repackage, whatever. Do fork it and add tests and help us work on it. That's critical to the project success. And then with an open source project, you get governance. And this has been a new interesting problem for us at Nitobi because we're all software developers. The entire company is made up of guys that write code. And something new to us is the issues of governance in an open source project. We're looking to contribute PhoneGap back to a foundation. Symbian has accepted the Symbian branch of PhoneGap, and it's going to be shipping as something called the Web Extensions package in Symbian 3, which is great. We may contribute back to Dojo or Apache the remaining code of PhoneGap so that there's contributor license agreements and the rest of the governance that comes with it. Or we may create a foundation. We don't know. And if any of the people here have any expertise in that, we want to listen to you. We're not interested in governance. We're interested in writing code. So a lot of people have been asking us for a long time to publish a roadmap. We have a roadmap of sorts in our wiki. It's this really ugly table where some cells are white, which means we haven't worked on it. Some cells are red, which means it's impossible for that platform. And some are yellow, which means we're working on it. And some are green, which means we've done it. This is not definitive at all. I'm going to talk to you guys about the higher level roadmap for PhoneGap and where it's going in the next few versions. So PhoneGap 1.0, we're actually getting very close to something that we're proud enough to call 1.0. We recently launched a new site. We're working on documentation a lot. The W3C recently ratified a messaging API with the Device API Working Group. And the messaging API would encompass SMS, MMS, email into one interface. It's quite nice. We've done a lot of client work doing real-time apps with XMPP, and so we've added it back to iPhone. It's coming for Android very soon, and BlackBerry. We've added native mapping functionality, which isn't something we loved that we had to do, but the performance characteristics of Google Maps embedded inside of a WebKit instance are poor at best. And when you add all this JavaScript into the page on some of these devices, not all of them, it can be overwhelming for your app. And so we've dropped down to native maps in cases where people need to use mapping functionality. It's something that may come out in the future as devices get better. The W3C also recently somewhat ratified file.io under the really long to type words file reader and file writer. And we're in the process of implementing that on all of our platforms. And we're documenting, which is something developers aren't very good at either. I would port it to the Newton if we could. That'd be awesome. So it's always good to know where you're going. So PhoneGap 1.1, there's a lot of different movement out there. And so there's another consortium group, I think they're mainly in Europe, called Bondi. And they're part of something called the Open Mobile Terminal Project. They have a set of device APIs they've been working on for quite some time. And we're looking to include those APIs with Deutsche Telekom back into PhoneGap. But we don't want to just have you choose one or the other. We want you to have the ability to mix and match. And so we're going to be implementing the common JS spec for require. So you'd be able to require in either Bondi's APIs or PhoneGap's APIs at your leisure as a developer. Or maybe you want to rewrite how it works and do your own abstraction. And so using the common JS require, that'll give us that ability. We're working with some friends in Europe on Samsung Bada, and we're going to be adding a notifications API at some point soon with Urban Airship, which is cool. PhoneGap 1.0 is all about getting the JavaScript interfaces and the tooling correct. We're not focusing on rendering. We believe that the browsers are solving that problem well enough for us. And so PhoneGap 2.0 is going to be about more native things, much like what Palm's been doing with their services in Mojo. And rendering, we believe the browsers are just going to solve this. In the case of, for example, BlackBerry, there's a really terrible browser, but we know a new one's coming. And so for us to force the hand of BlackBerry PhoneGap and write all this crazy DOM manipulation code to make it a decent browser would be a bit of a wasted effort with a new browser coming out. And we're going to be adding more platforms, and I don't know why they said a pony. We're not going to do that. Here's some really good resources, which we should probably publish more often. The Google group has a ridiculous number of people on it. I think there's like 2,500 people. It's extremely active. If you have a question, it'll probably get answered there. Before you ask a question, I encourage you to look on the wiki to see if it's already been answered. And if you want real-time feedback, the PhoneGap Twitter account actually is quite active too. And we always respond to people if they have a question on there. We're also often hanging out in IRC if you're into that sort of thing. Something coming soon to PhoneGap will be more tooling and automation. And so we first started the project with this ambitious side project called PhoneGap Dev, which was a build tool that would allow you to compile for all the platforms at once. And we found in practice this actually didn't work very well because you'd have to be running all the SDKs at once, and it just got ugly. We backed away from PhoneGap Dev, and we've been working actively on something called DroidScript. Actually, it's DroidGap. I don't know why it says DroidScript. And DroidGap's inside of our Android PhoneGap project. I think I have a little demo of it coming up, so I'll show it to you. It basically, we have shamelessly stolen a lot of the principles that Palm put forward with their developer tooling. It's very simple command line-based utilities for packaging, debugging, logging, all the good things you expect. And finally, there's a project called iBug. And this is a little bit nascent, but it's definitely worth checking out. I think the Aries debugger deprecates it. But iBug's cool because it allows you to attach a web inspector instance back to a running device by attaching a piece of remote JavaScript. It's totally nascent and it's early. It's by a guy named John Boxall who works at a company called MobifyMe in Vancouver. He gave me a demo where he was playing with Web Inspector in his browser, but he was like changing the background color and alerting on his Android phone, not connected in any way whatsoever. So that's really cool. That's something to watch out for. We hope to get all this stuff cleaned up for 1.0. Oh yeah, okay, so can you guys read that? Probably not very well. This is what happens when you run DroidGap. Basically, it gives you a series of options, and you just run DroidGap command and then any parameters it requires. For example, you can generate a new PhoneGap project. You can change directories into that project, type PhoneGap or DroidGap run, and it will compile it, package it, and deploy it to the first device it finds plugged in, which is really useful because you don't have to go through IDEs and the rest of the ceremony required with most of these platforms. And we're hoping to, so we, if we get things right with DroidGap, we're going to port it over to iPhone and the rest of the platforms, and then we'll write our big parent script, which will encapsulate them all. Okay, so that was the quick overview on PhoneGap. Does anyone have any questions on PhoneGap? I'm into answering anything you got for me on it. No? Yes. Native controls. No. You can, but we encourage you to not do native controls when we're doing mobile development. If you're going to do mobile development, as soon as you start instantiating native controls, you've killed any cross-platform play. And at that point, you may as well just do native development. Yes?
You mentioned briefly, I thought, is there a way, if you haven't already implemented the service or whatever you call them, that I can add a service to the feature you haven't added yet?
Yes. It's very easy. Yeah, augmenting PhoneGap is super simple. The trick is, if you want to extend PhoneGap, we're really open to accepting patches for every platform, but we want to maintain as much cross-platform as we can. But if it's a really cool feature that you add to, say, I don't know, the webOS, then that's going to kind of goad the other guys into adding it, especially if it comes with a test case. We'll almost certainly add it. Okay, yes. So PhoneGap's on 6 platforms. It's MIT licensed and it's standard based. The other options that you have for doing cross-platform development that are out there are not MIT licensed. They're not on more than 1 or 2 phones, and they aren't trying to adhere to any standards other than their own. That would be the key difference. Yes. Any which?
Any you know, shipping PhoneGap applications?
Yeah, there's tons of PhoneGap apps. If you go to phonegap.com/projects, there's a huge list. Unfortunately, most of those are iPhone, which maybe that'll change after today. So we'll do some more questions after. I want to get through the rest of this. So I have some other stuff to show you guys. So the first part was for us was getting device APIs and data back onto devices. Once we did that and we started writing mobile apps for all of our clients, we ran into some problems with DOM manipulation. So we wrote our own JavaScript framework, but why would you write your own JavaScript framework? And here's some pretty good reasons. When you're dealing with mobile, we've got a whole new set of characteristics in the target platforms that we're dealing with. We've got really small screens, pretty much no CPU, barely any RAM, no storage, sketchy connectivity, and these are actually probably good things because they bring us back to the root causes of why we do development. We're going to have to, you know, actually write the simplest thing that can possibly work and keep our apps constrained to that. I view these constraints as a benefit to mobile. So you've got these terrible performance characteristics, and then the first thing you do when you're going to go write a web app is grab your favorite JavaScript framework. And at the time when we were doing this, we were pretty heavily into using jQuery, but it was huge. It was 40K. The cache on an iPhone is about 25K. This is debatable now, but it doesn't matter. It would take a long time for our apps to start up. Once they did start up, they were very sluggish. And so we were like, well, what's going on? Why is this the case? The browser seems pretty fast. As soon as we ripped out the frameworks and started writing bare metal JavaScript, things got a lot better. Actually, it wasn't so bad on what we're calling our first class platforms, because most of these are running WebKit, and WebKit has a blazing fast JavaScript VM, either JavaScript Core, or in the case of the new Android and Palm WebOS V8, which is super fast. And we weren't too upset with this. And then we started actually going cross-platform and doing development for things like Windows Mobile and Nokia and BlackBerry. And that's when we were like, hey, we can't use a JavaScript framework. It just will not work. And that's when we started to write our own. When you start writing your own code, patterns start to emerge. And then XUI was born. So XUI is a jQuery work-alike. It's almost exactly the same in syntax, except for it's between 2 and 3 kilobytes. As opposed to 40, which is a massive win. You can focus on writing your app logic and you still get a DOM manipulation library. One of the key things about XUI is that we use conditional builds instead of conditional code. And so instead of having a large library that takes all cases into account, we have a series of small libraries built per platform. So we don't have a bunch of code for IE running inside of WebKit. It just doesn't make sense, especially in mobile. Something just to get out there, XUI is not a set of GUI widgets or controls. This isn't the problem we're trying to solve. I think Ben and Dion said it best when they said, if you build bespoke to the brand you're trying to build your app for, that's cross-platform. If you try and build to the GUI controls on the native device, that's not cross-platform. Who here is familiar with jQuery? Okay, fair chunk of you. In jQuery, there's a dollar sign function. You pass it a CSS selector, and it returns DOM elements, which you can usually iterate on and act on. To be cheeky, we called it X dollar sign. Most of the time when we're doing our development, we just reassign it. And here's some examples of grabbing DOM elements. Really simple stuff. You just give it a CSS selector. It returns all the elements that match that selector. You can also pass in literals, lists, arrays. Another thing to note when you're dealing with mobile, we found that it's nice to have really semantic, large CSS selector chains, but what you're doing when you do that is creating a whole bunch of lookups, and that's expensive. And if it's a large set of nodes, it gets especially expensive. So in that second case, while that looks beautiful, if we had just done dot selected, it would run faster. And that's something to keep in mind on these devices because they have such limited performance characteristics. XUI fully supports method chaining, so method chaining is when you can attach methods to methods. So here we've got the first list item, and we're attaching some HTML inside of it, and for whatever reason, we're coloring it blue, all in one line. That was sort of the big selling point of jQuery in the early days. Turns out it's not as testable as we'd like, but that's okay. We've got helpful methods for filtering DOM nodes. And then the sort of underpinning of all these types of apps, the ability to iterate over DOM nodes. So that's a big, ugly slide of code. DOM manipulation is pretty much the biggest key to doing mobile web app development. It's definitely the most important thing. We've added every possible way you can imagine to do it. Everything from inserting HTML anywhere in the DOM node list that you have to removing DOM elements to dealing with the attributes. We added a bunch of stuff for styles, mostly because at the time we were doing a whole bunch of cross-platform business and we found that we'd have to get a little bit conditional from browser to browser. I would recommend that you shy away from manipulating the style of your application from JavaScript, but you can if you have to. So it's in there. Adding classes and removing classes is cool. Using key value pairs to change CSS properties, that will bite you at some point in the future for sure. We have a whole bunch of abstractions around eventing, and eventing on mobile is totally different. And it's funny because a lot of people come to mobile and they're like, oh, why are my click events so slow? Because your finger doesn't actually click, it touches, right? And so touch start events aren't delayed, click events are in WebKit. Load method is questionable at best, DOM ready is probably better. We've added a new thing in PhoneGap called device ready, which XUI supports, and so the DOM being ready is one thing, but the device being ready to actually communicate back and forth between sensor data and the actual JavaScript running is another thing altogether. And orientation change, that's just something that's never come around before either. Beauty of the Palm SDK and Mojo is all the gesture libraries that you get for free. We don't get those for free in other libraries. I'm hoping Ben and Dion will champion getting that stuff open source for the other WebKit browsers. Because this whole gestures thing, there is no gestures library, so that's uncharted territory. And it'd be really nice if the expressiveness of WebOS gesturing could come into other platforms like Android. So there's an opportunity for a hacker.
So Android is not for free, the gesture library?
No. You get these events. So like, you get gesture start, gesture change, gesture end, but you don't get, say, swipe left, or swipe right, or pinch, zoom, rotate. So if you wanted those kinds of events, you'd have to author them yourself. That's something that we're looking at doing. And if anyone wants to hack on that in the next day or so, I'm totally into it. So come grab me. We have a working version of hardware-accelerated CSS transforms, transitions, and animations abstracted behind this tween interface. And it works quite well. But the problem is hardware-accelerated transforms, transitions, and animations currently only reside on the iPhone. We know they're coming to WebOS, as Ben and Dion talked about today. And I have hope it's going to come to Android at one point. I don't know what's going to happen with BlackBerry. And so in the meantime, we're using a library by Thomas Fuchs called Emil. And it's amazing. Most of the time when we're doing animations with XUI, we're just loading something from right to left. We're not doing anything super fancy with it. It's an area that needs improvement as well in the mobile web, just as a whole. So obviously, there's a lot of other options that are out there. Your alternatives, you could just develop for Palm exclusively. It looks like that Mojo Core will be coming out at some point, and that will hopefully be portable through all the PhoneGap projects. That would be awesome. JQ Touch is a pretty good example of WebKit programming, and it's worth checking out. It's pretty iPhone specific. I know it can run on WebOS, but it's a little bit buggy. And it just simply doesn't work on the other platforms. And so this really should be about writing for the mobile web first and bringing to native next. Dash code is possible. If you have a Mac, it's worth checking out just to look at it and then never open it again. And there's a new library coming out called Scroll Touch by Yuzibu. I don't know if they have a URL for it, but if you grab me, and I can look it up. And Scroll Touch gives you a native-like UI that works on iPhone and Android and Palm, the first-class platforms. So over the last couple of years, we've been doing all this software development for mobile, and we're starting to see some patterns emerge in our development techniques. One thing that we're finding very common is single-page apps. This is something encouraged by Palm already. It seems that this is the very best way to build your applications. We're also finding that when you get heavier with your JavaScript, eventually you start to have initialization penalties in your app logic or in your application as a whole. So Google were the first guys to do this, and I don't know who the crazy guy was that came up with this, but the technique is to take a script tag, put your JavaScript in it, comment it out, and then when you need it, you find that DOM element. You pull out that JavaScript, you strip the comments, and you eval it on the fly. Super evil. But it works. It works. It's fast, right? So you don't have the initialization penalty of interpreting that JavaScript. It's brilliant. And so we've been calling it the lazy eval technique, and we've been working on some build tooling for that, because obviously you don't want to write your JavaScript in a comment block. But this is a really good technique on older phones and less capable browsers, for sure. And another pattern that's been emerging that we've been finding that we've been doing conditional builds for different platforms. BlackBerry is just a terrible, terrible browser, and we have to fix it. But there's no sense in shipping a bunch of code that fixes BlackBerry's browser on WebOS, for example. So conditional builds have become a more common technique. And these aren't things that we've solved necessarily. These are just observations that we've had and opportunities for the developer community to pitch in, for sure. So the last bit, yes?
Keep on talking about the RIM, the BlackBerry browser.
Yeah.
Heard the latest browser, is that based on WebKit? Is that going to make your life easier if you look at it?
Yeah, so I did see it in Mobile World Congress, so I know it exists. RIM picked up a company called Torch Mobile, which made a thing called the Iris browser. The Iris browser was a WebKit. They put a bunch of job postings on LinkedIn for WebKit hackers. They've promised us a WebKit by Q2, which is sometime in the next couple months. So we know RIM's coming out with a new browser, and that's good. But there's still a lot of dudes that have BlackBerry 4.6 and 4.7, and until we get access to that, like until that browser is released, we just don't know. But I wouldn't count out RIM, that's for sure. There's a lot of people that love their BlackBerries, so.
BlackBerry 5.
It is BlackBerry 5. BlackBerry 5 will have a WebKit. Apparently, it'll be an over-the-air update, so. Until it's released, who knows? So I'm going to talk a little bit about offline now and a library that I wrote called Lawnchair. It sounds like Ben and Dion are getting into fixing this problem too, which is awesome, their DB8 technology, and I'm excited to see how that works because Lawnchair, it was just yet another side effect of doing mobile development at Nitobi. It's a quirky name. PhoneGap apps themselves are intrinsically offline because they live on the device. So offline itself is somewhat solved with PhoneGap, except for storing data. And File.io should help that. Something to think about when you're about to go offline, you've got web apps, which we have the cache manifest, which is an HTML5 innovation, which will allow us to write fully offline capable applications once it's not as buggy as it currently is. And then you have hybrid apps like PhoneGap that run on the device that don't need a cache manifest because you've already cached the static assets. But you need to know if you're online or offline, and that's what a reachability API is all about. Once you get offline, then you need to store data. And so there's a whole bunch of techniques for doing this. We could use cookies. No one wants to use cookies. There's DOM storage, which is good, but it doesn't work in all browsers. There's SQLite, which is also good, but it's different in many of the different variants of WebKit, which is interesting. And then there's other hacks. You could use Flash, for example, which wouldn't work in most mobile cases, window.name, et cetera. These are all really bad for a whole bunch of different reasons. DOM storage is nice, but it's just storing primitives, which isn't very useful, because we probably want to store, you know, JSON. SQLite seemed like a good idea at some time, but then when you think about all the fun you've had with relational databases over your software development career, maybe putting a SQLite database in the browser isn't such a good idea after all. That's my opinion. So Lawnchair is just a lightweight document store. You just chuck JSON at it, and you get JSON back. It's designed for mobile. We use it in almost all of our Nitobi projects. It's really simple, and we're employing what we call the adapter pattern, which allows us to plug in different data stores. So here's an example of instantiating a Lawnchair. In this case, I'm saying I want a Lawnchair, and I want to use the DOM adapter, so I'm going to use DOM storage for this. The DOM storage adapter is cool because it falls back to the window.name hack, so it actually works in all modern desktop browsers as well as most mobile devices. In this example, I'm creating a little snippet of JSON, or really a JavaScript object literal, and I'm saving it. All right, pretty simple. Everything in Lawnchair is asynchronous, and so after a save, we can have a callback function. And you can make up your own keys. If you don't make up a key, it'll just create a UUID for you on the fly. If you want to get a record, it's similar. I've got shortcuts for a lot of things. Dojo, last year at JSConf, Peter Higgins was showing me, Dojo has these comprehensions where you can pass in string literals, and it'll blow it up into a function callback, which is a really nice terse way of, so we could, actually, yeah, these two lines are actually identical. So it just saves you some keystrokes. Really nice way to do that. Removing records is just as simple. When I was testing, I needed a way to get rid of all the records, so I added a nuke method. It's kind of funny. It stayed in there. And then there's other helpful stuff like iterators for going through records. And that's really all there is to Lawnchair. It's super, super simple. There's a find method which will allow you to pass two callbacks. The first callback is a conditional. If that conditional evaluates as true, it'll execute the second callback on that record. You can do the shorthand syntax with that, which is really nice. And it leads to like really terse, simple code, a lot better than writing SQL statements in the browser. And so that's all I got for you guys. Does anyone have any more questions?
Does the Lawnchair stuff work in BlackBerry?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. I believe when we're doing BlackBerry, we use the DOM adapter. You have to use a specific adapter for each one, but I believe DOM adapter is the one that our guy Phil is using. We've also just, because we're adding file.io back into PhoneGap, we're going to augment with a file.io based adapter for Lawnchair so that it just writes it straight down to disk.
I was wondering if you can give some, you know, based on your hits to your website or people who are downloading PhoneGap.
Right.
What are the trends you're seeing, like, not absolute, but relative trends in growth, say which platform you're seeing acceleration, which you're seeing some moderation, which you think are totally, you know.
That's a great question. So he just wants to know a few stats about PhoneGap and what trends that we're seeing emerge. It's cool. So being software developers, we threw up a really ghetto web page to represent PhoneGap, and we didn't really update it. And then we realized in like January that we didn't have any analytics on that page. And so we're like, maybe we should put some analytics on. And I can say as of today, since January, PhoneGap's been downloaded 250,000 times. So it's getting a huge amount of adoption. The trend that we're seeing in our last training session, it used to be, who here does iPhone development? Who here does Android development? The whole room would be doing iPhone development. We're seeing a trend now towards actually a pretty even mix between iPhone, Android. And then there's always the stragglers around BlackBerry, webOS, and the rest of it. We're also seeing a lot of people coming to us now not to build PhoneGap apps, but to build web apps, mobile web apps. And so I think a lot of businesses are seeing their mobile web app traffic go up, and they're realizing that it's time to bring their sites into the mobile world. And this is a clear indication of where the mobile web itself is going. Yeah. Is there any other questions about PhoneGap? In some platforms, we get access to shared memory spaces, and in others, like iPhone, we don't. We do now, recently. App-to-app communication, probably best achieved through a web interface, in my opinion. But I mean, on a case-by-case basis, this can be achieved. It's really easy to do in Android, for example, and it looks like Palm's adding APIs to Mojo for that, too. So it depends on what you're targeting. I think if you build to a web app, you're going to get the most reach and the most win.
The example that you use, that you're saying that you write in cookies to share, you know,
oh yeah, in the case of BlackBerry, yeah.
Is that acceptable? I mean, is it accessible to other applications?
I don't see why not, yeah. So the question is, when in the case of BlackBerry specifically, in the case of BlackBerry, we're writing to a shared memory space. We're basically reading and writing cookies constantly, and the question was, can other apps take advantage of this? And I believe other apps could take advantage of this, yes. Absolutely.
One of the biggest challenges we face is the fact that my end users frequently are in situations where they have no connectivity.
Yes.
So I have to capture data and hold it until I get a network connection.
Right.
And so I know as you were flashing through, I thought I saw a connectivity function.
So we have something for connectivity in PhoneGap. We've got the reachability API. PhoneGap apps are just offline apps, so it'll work online or offline. You have to architect in that way. And then you can use the reachability API. Am I online? Yes, sweet. Let's do some synchronization routine of some kind. If you're not offline, then...
So I can use Lawnchair to hold
the data
until...
You find online.
Notices that it's online.
Yeah.
But on... Is the Lawnchair data persistent if the end user, being an idiot, closes the app?
Yeah, Lawnchair is persistent. It's persistent if the save callback gets called.
Okay.
As soon as that save callback is executed, the data has been persisted.
Even on the BlackBerry.
Yes. I'll confirm that one though.
Understand why I said that.
Yes.
BlackBerry persistent storage is such a nightmare.
It is, yes. Yes, let's talk afterwards. I'll give you my card, yeah.
I'd love to.
Does anybody else have any PhoneGap related questions? At all? Nope. Thanks a lot, everyone.